So, on the heels of the release of a new set of remarkably buggy Pokémon games, Matt Parker just recently released a video on his second channel about the weirdly broken calculator app in Pokémon Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl. You can see here, it just straight up gives you the wrong answer sometimes, along with all sorts of other buggy behavior. But these bugs depend on the region your Switch is set to. So in the US and Japan, works fine, but in Germany, it breaks. For the rest of the video, what Matt does is basically speculate about why all this weirdness is happening. And they disclaim that they don't actually know what language this game was written in, they don't have access to the source code or anything like that. So all of their theories are just that, pure conjecture, educated guesses, so on and so forth. And that's the part that nerd sniped me. Because, of course, we do know what language Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl were written in. They are quite famously Unity games, meaning in all likelihood they were written in C#. And Unity games, really C# apps in general, are notoriously easy to reverse engineer. How could I resist getting to the bottom of this bug? Now, before we go any further, this video is not meant to be a tutorial about reverse engineering Switch games. I am definitely not the person to make that tutorial. This is my first time doing anything like this. But I did want to at least share a high-level overview of the process I went through. So if you're interested, stick around. Otherwise, there are timestamps in the description. You can skip ahead to when we're talking about the actual calculator. Anyway, getting back. Just as an example, let's grab any random Unity game from my Steam library. Can't go wrong with Neon White. And we can see if we browse that game's files on my SSD, we find this file called assemblyc#.dll. Now that's the file that actually contains the game's code. It's in the Common Intermediate Language. If you know Java, you can think of it as just Java bytecode. And we can open that DLL in an IDE, say Rider, and we can actually browse Neon White's source code. Now it's not going to be the original source code, you know, whatever they checked into their Git repo, but it's pretty damn close. We've got class names, method names, decompiled code within those methods, and even local variable names, all ripe for reverse engineering. But what about Pokémon? I can't just browse these files on my computer. Well, first we need to get our hands on a dump of Pokémon Brilliant Diamond or Shining Pearl, and specifically, we're going to go with version 1.0.0. That's what's on the cartridge, and that's what's the buggiest. Now, there are lots of ways to get Switch ROMs, but as it turns out, I do, in fact, own both of these games completely legally. So, if anyone asks, I got my hands on the Brilliant Diamond ROM by legally dumping it from my very own Switch. Then, we can use this handy app called NSTool to extract the actual file system from the ROM image. And if we browse that file system, we see a lot of what we expect. Graphics, sounds, models, so on and so forth. Already a ton of fun, but what we're interested in is the code, and that lives in this file called main. Unfortunately, this file is not an IL assembly. This is a raw ARM64 executable. That's because Unity games compiled for the Switch generally use a function in Unity called IL2CPP, which takes your IL bytecode, transpiles it into C++, then compiles that C++ into an actual binary. So we're gonna have to hop through a few more hoops. First, we can use this tool, IL2CPP dumper, which takes as input that raw binary and some metadata from elsewhere in the file system, and is actually able to recover a version of the assembly C#.dll file. Now, if we open that file in Rider, we see a lot of what we expect to see, a whole bunch of classes and methods. And as someone who has spent too much of his life reading reverse-engineered Pokémon source code recently, this is a veritable treasure trove of information. But right now, we are on a mission. All we care about is the calculator app, and we can find that class under the dpr.ui namespace, in a file appropriately named pokeappcalc.cs. Looking through that file, again, we see a lot of what we expect. We've got fields like max digits, calc mode, and methods like input numeric and input digit point. This sure looks like a class that would define a calculator, but what's missing here is the actual source code. See, this assembly C#.dll file is really just a dummy. It's basically a header file. If we want to study the actual code, we'll need a disassembly. And since I don't want to pay for IDA, we'll have to go with the next best thing, Ghidra, an open source disassembler developed by the NSA, in combination with Ghidra Switch Loader, a plugin for Ghidra that allows it to understand Switch binary files. So, we import the binary into Ghidra. We see it's already detected as a Nintendo Switch binary. Once the import is done, we open it in the disassembler. Ghidra's gonna offer to analyze it for us, but this is a huge binary, it's over 30 megabytes, so it's gonna take too long. So let's decline for now. Then if we head back to the output of the IL to CPP dumper, we find there, aside from the DLL, we have some header files, some JSON files, and some Python scripts. Those are what we'll need. First off, we use IL to CPP header to Ghidra.py to convert the header file to a format that Ghidra understands. Over in Ghidra then, we can add that new header file, IL to CPP Ghidra.h, as a C source file. Turn off some of the options, let it import faster, and then once that's done, we import the script called Ghidra with struct.py into Ghidra, run that, and pass in the script.json file that we got earlier. Now, with all of that done, finally, Ghidra understands our C# header files, which should make reverse engineering a lot easier. First, we head over to the symbol tree and search for the class we're looking for, Poketch App Calc. Then we can select all of the functions with that prefix and ask Ghidra to disassemble them. Then if we head into one of those functions, say input numeric, we see our disassembly and our decompilation. And yeah, it's still not great. We've got method and field names, but you know, it's still C# code that's been compiled, transpiled, compiled again, and finally decompiled. It's not gonna be pleasant to read, and we don't have any local variable names to work with. But we do at least know where to look now. We have a somewhat sensible code structure to study, and we can even see some API calls. We've got calls to methods like system.string.equality, unityengine.setenabled, and pokechappcalc.updateNumberImage. So from here, we can study this code and try to recreate it in C#. And well, that's exactly what I did. I went function by function, line by line, and created what I think to be a perfect recreation of the PokeEtch calculator app, bugs and all. Only now, we've got actual readable source code that we can debug. So with all of that work finally done, we can play with the calculator some. It should match the functionality of the calculator in the game exactly. Although, if you're following along at home, keep in mind that I am using version 1.0.0 of the game for this. They have actually released some patches to fix the calculator in the interim. Also, if you're following along at home and you want to try debugging this yourself, I have a link to my demo and source code in the description, so pause now if you care to noodle that over. Anyway, the basic functionality works as expected. 2 plus 2 does indeed equal 4. 3.14159 times 2 equals 6.28 and so forth. We can divide no problem. 5 divided by 2 gets us 2.5. 7 divided by 3 gives us a nice repeating decimal. Seems like a reasonably functional calculator. Already though, we can see some things that behave maybe not how we would expect a calculator to behave. For example, after we input a number, pick an operation, and then enter the next number, we can just kind of change the operator that's used for the calculation. Or if we try, say, 10 divided by 0, the answer is 10? And suppose we click the dot button twice. Well, then the entire calculator just locks up. It stops responding to any inputs until we hit the clear button. So, it's definitely a quirky calculator, but I wouldn't describe it as fundamentally broken. But let's try it again, this time setting our Switch's language to German. And this time, if we boot up the Taschenrechner in Pokémon Stahlender Diamant, we find that things are a bit different. 2 plus 2 does thankfully still equal 4, but trying, say, 5 divided by 2 gets us 002. 7 over 3 is 3, apparently. Now let's try pi, 3.14... Oh, something's going wrong here. Multiply that by 2, well, it's the right answer, but it's missing the decimal. Now let's try typing 123.123. Well, it gets it right in the end, I guess. Okay, the last thing, let's try typing 1.2.3. Total nonsense that, and it seems to have given up on us, but let's try multiplying that by 2, and what do you know, it's 246. Wow. Okay, what's going on here? Well, as Matt correctly speculated, it all has to do with number locales. Many places like the US, UK, Japan use a dot to separate decimal numbers, with a comma for the thousand separator. But many places like Germany, France, Spain do the opposite. They have a comma for the decimal and dots to separate the thousands. So, some programming languages, like C#, when you ask it to convert a number to a string or a string to a number, it will by default use the locale of the system they're running on. In fact, when I was implementing this code, Ryder even yelled at me about that. So, pro tip, if you're making a game for millions of people around the world, maybe pony up the $20 for ReSharper. Anyway, Matt was right about the root cause, but the exact mechanisms of the bug are very slightly different from how he speculated, so let's break it down. First, what happens when you type in 5 divided by 2 and you get 002? So things mostly work as you'd expect. You type 5, and you can see this dispNumString variable updates to 5. Then we hit the divide button, the 5 moves into currentNum, and the calc mode becomes divide. We type 2, it goes into dispNumString, and then we hit equals, and it does the division. And you can see here the right answer ends up in dispNumString. It's 2.5, just with a comma instead of a dot. So the issue happens here in input equals. You can see here they assign dispNumString to currentNum.toString. Now I've passed in a specific locale here to let us see the different behavior, but in the original game, this method call was unqualified, which results in 2,5 in the German locale. But why does that display as 002? Well, let's head into the updateNumberImage method to see what's happening. The very first thing this method does is try to parse the number into a decimal object using decimal.tryParse with the current locale. Of course, that succeeds, and we get 2.5 as we'd expect, since the locales match. We're passing in 2,5, and that's what it expects. Next, there's some logic for handling negatives, but then we try to split the number into its decimal and integer parts, and this is where things start to go wrong. So, they try to find the index of the decimal point by calling index of with a literal dot string. Of course, this fails, so we skip over all this logic that's supposed to handle a decimal number, and we find that the integer part is the literal string 2,5, while the decimal part remains the empty string. We again end up skipping over all this logic that's supposed to handle the decimal, and end up at this method called setNumImage. This is what actually updates the calculator's display. This method takes three parameters: the number to display, the number of digits in that number, and the offset from the right to display that number at. Now normally this method would get called twice, first to render the decimal digits and then to render the integer part, but here we're calling it just once. And notice we pass in not the string 2,5, but the number that we successfully parsed from before, 2.5, cast to an int, which ends up being the number 2. However, for the number of digits parameter, we do use the 2,5 string to get a length of 3. So, what's happening inside this method? Basically, a whole bunch of maths. We've got a do while loop that repeats the number of times you passed in for the number of digits, so 3. Each loop, it divides the number you specified by consecutive powers of 10, so 1, 10, 100, grabs the least significant digit, that is to say, the rightmost, and renders it to the display. So you can probably see where this is going now. We start with a 2, render a 2, divide that by 10, convert it to an int, and we get 0, render that 0, divide by 100, we still get 0, so we render that second 0, and then finish the loop. 002. Okay, let's work through one more example. What's happening when you type a number like 12.345, and the display ends up showing 45.345. So 1, 2, and even the decimal all work fine, it seems. We can see dispNumString and parseNumber are both what we'd expect. After all, clicking the dot button is not locale specific. That always just puts a literal dot character into dispNumString. But what happens now when we type 3? Let's take a look in input numeric, skipping over all the irrelevant logic for now, and we find exactly what you'd expect. We take dispNumString and concatenate it with the number we just typed. No locale weirdness going on here. And indeed, we can see the value of disp num string is as we'd expect. So again, something's going wrong in update number image. So like before, we try to parse disp num string, and it succeeds, but not the way you'd expect. This time, the locales don't match. So when we parse the string 1, 2, dot, 3, decimal.tryParse sees that dot as a thousand separator and happily ignores it. We can see the result of this parse is the number 123. Now, we get to the logic for handling decimals, and indeed, this number has a dot. So we grab the index of that dot, it's 2, 0, 1, 2, and there's a lot of weird compiler output logic here, but the end result is that it does successfully split the string into the integer part, 1, 2, and the decimal part, 3. So we have a decimal part this time, so we parse that number, 3, into an int, and pass it to setNumImage. There's no locale weirdness going on here, so it does successfully draw a 3 in the calculator's display. But now it's time to render the integer part. So far we've just been rendering things aligned to the right, but for the integer part we need to make sure that we render it to the left of the decimal. So we calculate the integer offset by adding 1 to the decimal position, and now we call setNumImage. The number that we're trying to render, remember, is the decimal that we parsed from before, 123. The length is the length of the integer string that we split from before. That's the string 1, 2. So the length is 2. And the offset is actually correct. So we end up in a do while loop, which this time only iterates twice. We render the 3 from 1, 2, 3, then the 2, and then we break, never rendering the 1 anywhere. Finally, back in the original method, we render the dot, and that works as expected. 23.3. Okay, if you stuck around this long, I hope you had some fun. Maybe you even learned something. Obviously, there's a lot more weirdness that happens with this calculator. So as I mentioned before, I've got links to my demo and source code in the description. I personally find it a ton of fun to play around with the calculator, see what all broken behaviors I can find, and then try and find the code responsible for that behavior. And if that tickles your fancy, well, you know where to find those links. But also, if you like this weird sort of intersection of Pokemon, programming, and mathematics, oh boy howdy do I have some YouTube videos I think you would like. I definitely recommend checking out my Scientifically Ranking the Pokemon Trainers series. Lots of fun reverse engineering and math going on there. There's 2 videos in the series so far, and the third, which will be about Pokemon Crystal, well, it's coming along, slow and steady, as they say. So, if you want to see that when it eventually comes out, be sure to subscribe. Thanks for watching.